Good morning and welcome, everyone. Scottsdale Forward is our signature event development around economics undertaken by the Scottsdale Area Chamber of Commerce. This initiative is held every year and is an opportunity to learn, inform, and create conversation. Our goal is to address with the business community the economic development vision, needs, and current experiences in our city from a diverse perspective. A special acknowledgement to Dr. Jan Gaylor and Scottsdale Community College for hosting us in our event today. I would also like to take a moment to recognize our mayor, city council members joining us today. Scottsdale City Mayor Jim Lane. Councilperson Virginia Corti. Virginia. And council member Linda Milhaven. This event would not be possible without the support of all the organizations that sponsored this event. The Scottsdale Area Chamber of Commerce would like to thank all the sponsors who make today possible. Our presenting sponsor, Cox Business. Our CEO panel sponsor, Arizona Public Service. Our executive sponsor, Comerica Bank. Our corporate sponsors, Arizona Best Real Estate, Banner Behavioral Health, Cigna, Nationwide Insurance Company, Salt River Project, and Wells Fargo. Our breakfast sponsors, DMB, First Bank, Jane Blacker, Russ Lyon Sotheby's International Realty, and Security Title Agency. And our in-kind sponsor, Scottsdale Community Colleges and Pro One Media Productions. Thank you all for today's sponsors and your continued support of the Scottsdale Area Chamber of Commerce. At this time, I would like to introduce our Master of Ceremonies, Don Henninger. Don spent over 30 years in the newspaper business in the Valley with the Arizona Republic and later the Phoenix Business Journal. He left 2 years ago to pursue new ventures on his own and is currently the director of SCOT, the Scottsdale Coalition of Today and Tomorrow. SCOT is a new pro-Scottsdale group of business and civic leaders whose aim is to educate and advocate for issues important to the city's future. Don, again.
Thanks, Mark, and good morning, Scottsdale. What a day in paradise again. We have a Chamber of Commerce day we have today, wouldn't you say? Honored to be your master of ceremonies today for what I know is going to be an absolutely outstanding program, chock full of information that we're all going to learn from. So a wonderful morning ahead to get things started. I'd love to welcome our host this morning, Scottsdale Community College President, Dr. Jan Gaylor.
That's the way.
Thanks, Don. When that happened, I told him this is probably likely the first of many comedic moments today. But seriously, on behalf of the faculty, the student affairs professionals, and the many, many people who make this a very special place, welcome to Scottsdale Community College, your community college. We are the only public two-year institution that sits on tribal land, and we are here as the guests of the Salt River Pima Maricopa Indian community. If you get a chance to stroll across this beautiful campus, you'll quickly understand how we are serious about our stewardship responsibilities of both the place and the spirit of the people. Scottsdale Forward, I think we are thrilled to host what I believe is the fifth Scottsdale Forward, and fitting with today's agenda, I want to share with you something you may or may not know about the college. We have a principle that guides and directs us in so many ways, and it is that we believe that we serve our students best by connecting with the community first. Many of you out there in the audience are partners with the college in one way or the other, helping to make the very best instruction possible and service to our students in our communities. I want to single out one in particular this morning, so a little bit of a point of privilege. This entity has created internships, which you all probably know, are opportunities for our students to experience the real world of work and learn while they are studying. And most recently, this entity was generous enough to award us a $10,000 gift to support our service learning program. Service learning, for those of you who might or might not know, the vernacular in the academy, it's a pedagogy, but what it really means is that our faculty help our students learn by engaging in service throughout the community, and then, as importantly, and maybe more importantly, coming back to the campus, to the classroom, to reflect on the importance of the principals involved and the importance to them as an individual, but most importantly, to their community and their service. So I want to say a special thank you to Nationwide and Doreen Renke. So I know she's out there in the audience somewhere or probably backstage, but thank you, Doreen. She is one among many living examples that when we partner together, everyone wins and benefits. And of course, you've heard me say, and the mayor has repeated this a number of times, Scottsdale is a great place to live, learn, work, and play. So with that, I invite you, as I always do, to find 30 minutes, push away from the desk, put the phone down, step away from the boardroom or the conference room, come to campus, stroll the one or more of our 160 acres of beautiful, beautiful campus life here to savor the sights and sounds of artichoke land. So come on back to school. Enjoy the day, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Gaylor, and thank you all that you do for everything you do and the college does for our community. We really appreciate it. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the mayor of Scottsdale, the Honorable Jim Lane.
Good morning, everyone. You know, it's just another wonderful Scottsdale day. I like to use that word since Bob Parsons used it for this, designating the state, but it's certainly just another wonderful Scottsdale day. I want to thank the chamber for really assembling what is going to be a fantastic presentation in the panel or the discussion of some of the top executives in our area here today to talk about economic development and their businesses here in Scottsdale. And also to bring to us, to all of us, a prominent economist, one of the best known economists that we have here in the Valley and the state and probably even in the Southwest, Elliott Pollack, who I might also say lends himself to a statistic we just got yesterday. Some of you may have seen what WalletHub came up with. Anybody see that report? We're the 13th happiest city in the country. And I'm proud to say that Mr. Pollack is a happy resident of our downtown and has been for a number of years. So I'm glad that he has lent to that statistic. And incidentally, we're only one of two cities in the state of Arizona that got that designation. And I won't make you guess, but Gilbert is 16th. So. But, you know, I think we probably all do know here in this room that the city of Scottsdale has been engaged into a high level of making sure that we have a positive business environment and that we are doing our part to provide a platform for businesses and for our own economic development here in Scottsdale for a number of years. And that has been very successful, not only in bringing the jobs and the investment into Scottsdale, but also bringing valuations to our properties. Our home values and our property values in Scottsdale have fully recovered, certainly, and then some. And some areas have actually been transformed into some of the hottest areas in town. And some of those that seemingly were the most distressed are really on a very, very positive path of recovery. So it's been a very good thing. One of the stats on that level is that 13.6% increase between 2012 and 2016 in the number of, in the increase in jobs in Scottsdale. And a lot of that is based heavily on some of the areas of greatest interest to us, and that would be certainly financial sector services industry, as well as biotech and healthcare sciences. And so it has been an amazing transformation, even in the regeneration of an economic engine and diversifying that. Tourism is still strong, and it still forms a very significant and basic element of not only our economy, but our overall environment. So it's been positive. So needless to say, I'm bullish on Scottsdale. And I think everybody in this room hope shares exactly the same reason and thinking as far as that's concerned. So let me thank you all for your interest, your attendance, your interest, and your commitment to our fine city. And thanks for being here.
Thank you, Mayor Lane, for that happy message, as well as for your leadership overall. Really appreciate it. Next, let's welcome Martin Javier, Vice President of the Salt River Pima Maricopa Indian Community. Martin.
Good morning, everyone. As mentioned, my name is Martin Harvier. I'm the Vice President of the Salt River Pima Maricopa Indian Community. I'd like to thank the Chamber for organizing the event this morning, and Scottsdale Community College and Dr. Geller of hosting the event this morning. It's good to see everyone out there. I was coming in, I was led into the building, and I mentioned what a beautiful day it is outside. And in Arizona, if we can put up with 3 months of heat, the rest of the year is beautiful here in Arizona. Part of my welcoming you to the community, Scottsdale Community College is located on our community, and we really appreciate, again, Dr. Gellin, the relationship that we have with the college in offering education to our membership if they desire to further their education. The door has always been open here, and I'm really grateful for the relationship that we have with the college. And it was good to see Mayor Lane this morning, and a relationship that we have as a community with Mayor Lane. It's always good to see him. You know, and welcome you to the community. I was kind of thinking about your theme of moving Scottsdale forward. Well, speaking to a group last week, the Scottsdale leadership, and woohoo, and. You know, I kind of mentioned by zip code, we are Scottsdale. And things that we do here in our community, we've been able in the last few years is to benefit from economic development along the corridor. And we really believe the things that we do here in the community not only benefit us, but benefit the region. And that's great, you know, that we can work with each other and be good neighbors with each other. But it always wasn't like that. And I think my message today, yesterday I had an opportunity to have one of our youth council shadow. Well, I had one that kind of went with me for the morning and took him around our government complex. And I'll let you know right now, our government complex, our staff right now, the last number that I received, we have 1,860 employees of our tribal government. And a lot of them are not community members. So we do employ a lot of non-natives, non-community members that, again, it helps out the area, the region. And we want to say again that we help in other ways. And that's just the government, not including the enterprises that we have within the government. But I took this young man around the community, kind of showed the community to him. And I started thinking about what I was going to say here this morning. And I thought about yesterday's visit. And I took him to the north part of our community where it's the farming area, the vegetables that are growing. The Pimas and the Maricopas, the tribes that are here in Salt River, were known as farmers. And I had to tell this young man that right now we don't have any community members that are farming any of the community land that you see under farming right now. There's it's leased to outside farmers that come in. And that's kind of sad, you know, to where we're at. And I started thinking about just us as a people and being farmers, and the history says that the Pimas and the Maricopas from here in Salt River originated from down on the Gila River Reservation. The Maricopas and the Pimas are also down on the Gila River Reservation. And they say that our ancestors moved into this area to continue farming off the Salt River. And it's really kind of a wonderful sight to see the Salt River running right now with all the rain that we have. And it kind of just makes you think about what it was like in the past. And again, being farmers and somebody making a decision to say, I have to leave. I have to leave my family to continue to provide for my family. So I'm leaving, and it's only 35 miles, but back then, I'm sure it was a long ways. But somebody said, I have to leave, and others followed. And in this program, leadership is so important on what you're going to do and moving things forward. And to see what we're benefiting today as leadership, as members of this community, it took somebody back then to say, I got to go. I have to leave to benefit my family, to move things forward. And I think that's the message of your event, is that of the group, to move Scottsdale forward, to move things forward, to look into the future. And that's what we should all have in mind when we do things, to work together, to move things forward for not only ourselves, but our future. And with that, have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin, for that great, those great words of wisdom, and also for your leadership as well. Really appreciate it. Next up, we're going to bring up to the stage Danielle Casey. She's the City of Scottsdale Economic Development Director. Danielle was recently selected as a winner in the Economic Development Professions 40 Under 40, which is the only award of its kind recognizing young talent in the economic development profession. Big round of applause for Danielle.
All right. You know, you never mention a lady's age except in times like that, right? All right, everybody. Well, I want to again thank the Chamber for inviting me to be a repeat offender at this event. I'm always humbled by their willingness to put me on this stage, but in seriousness, Mark Hegel's support, the whole team's support has been unbelievable. Whenever we ask for help or say we're working on something, does the Chamber want to get involved? They are right there every step of the way. So I really appreciate that tremendously. I'd like to also recognize the huge role that our partners, the Greater Phoenix Economic Council, as well as the Arizona Commerce Authority, play in marketing our region on a national and international scale and drive business to Scottsdale. I've had the honor of spending almost 4 years now here in this role, and so I consider this a friendly audience and have gotten to know many of you very well. So rather than make you listen to me for my entire 10 minutes, I'm gonna go ahead and just kick this off with a fun message of how we are looking at and pitching Scottsdale from our creative team, as well as a message from one of our companies, please.
My name is Jeff, and this is my Scottsdale. You know, when I got my job offer to come move to Phoenix, I sat down with the family and with the kids, and we talked it over. And our perception at first was that, hey, we're moving to the surface of the sun, that it was going to be really hot and miserable, that there's scorpions, cactus everywhere, not a lot of greenery. And we were actually shocked as we drove down at how beautiful the landscape was. We went through the Flagstaff area, Sedona, those areas, and it was absolutely gorgeous. And I thought, hey, I'm just back in Park City, and this is only a couple hours away. We love living in the Phoenix area. Where we moved from was a real outdoors area, and you know, most people consider Phoenix to be pretty much a desert, which is great in the winter time. But in the summer, it can be pretty hot. Well, we found that just in an hour drive, you can be up in the mountains. I was surprised to find out that the largest ponderosa pine forest in the world is an hour away from my house. We're about 20 minutes from water skiing on a lake, and there's just all kinds of trails and things to do. It's like with Phoenix, you have the amenities of the big city, but in your communities, it feels like a bedroom. It feels like a neighborhood. And I really like that. We've lived all over the country, actually. And I feel like the city itself has more to offer than any of those areas that we lived in. Just there's so much to do.
So if you want to get in on the fun, this is just the start of a series that our team is taping called This Is My Scottsdale. So give us a call and we can get you in the queue. As you all know, our existing firms create 80% of net new jobs, making these testimonials significant. So I'm going to leave the economy to our economist, but wanted to spend a few minutes on the strength of our primary industry sectors. Since 2013, Scottsdale has been outperforming the region, state, and country. All of our target sectors have been expanding, specifically tech, biolife sciences, finance, and insurance, and 9 out of 10 of the companies that we have visited have been expanding and hiring. 2013 coincided with a wave of hiring in the tech space, as local firms like Bolst, Digital Airstrike, GPS Insight, Early Warning Systems all underwent expansions, while firms from both coasts like Yelp, Weebly, and ZocDoc focused on downtown Scottsdale as their new growth location. After a 2015 slowdown, firms are resuming hiring and beginning to move not just sales, but software development positions to the city. Overall, the Scottsdale computer-related workforce has actually seen an increase of 30% since 2012, compared to 12 nationally and 18 regionally. In recent months, this has been further evidenced with new company celebrations. You may be familiar with Ingenue, ClearLink, and MindBuddy. While the tech sector was stabilizing, the Scottsdale financial services workforce increased 35% since 2012 compared to 19 nationally and 28 regionally due to overall sector recovery and a desire of financial services firms to diversify westward. Existing companies like Vanguard, Nationwide, and Quicken Loans have accounted for a large percentage, actually, of the recent hiring in Scottsdale, and new locates like Hartford Insurance, LearnVest, APL Logistics, and Accolade are creating upward of 1,000 new jobs. Our educational partners are responding, with coursework and underwriting being added at both ASU and Maricopa Community Colleges. Scottsdale insurance-related occupations increased 46% from 2012, compared to under 11% nationally. And this was really apparent after Hurricane Sandy caused some disruption to many large firms on the East Coast. So with a large quality workforce and a lack of natural hazards, it's no wonder that Greater Phoenix and Scottsdale is a preferred destination. Finally, the biolife sciences sector has remained stable. Scottsdale jobs increased 13.5% from 2012 to 16, compared to 11.7 in the region. So please stay tuned for increased efforts from our team to support the growth in this sector through new strategies like expanding on our brand as a destination medical community. It's an honor to work with all of these companies every day. And recently, I presented an update to the City Council regarding the top accomplishments since the approval of the city's economic development strategic plan. So just a few. It's been a year of first-time services and programs, think tank discussions with key business sectors, a 5-week small business training series in partnership with the Chamber, and of course our Weebly website and night events. A talent attraction initiative designed to help Scottsdale firms find, recruit, and retain the talent they need has included exhibiting at trade shows like the South by Southwest Job Market. And more recently, we offered programming for the benefit of local business recruiters where they heard from companies like LinkedIn and recruiting.com. In fact, I'm excited to share, we're one of the first users of a new artificial intelligence tool called Olivia that was developed by recruiting.com, which is transforming the process of engaging with new applicants by offering them to simply text to apply for a job. Works really well with millennials. And finally, this past year, we formally engaged with the Canada Arizona Business Council for its Stunning Wings and Wheels event, drawing more than 900 registrants. Since July of 2015, we've conducted more than 160 business visits, representing more than 4,500 new jobs. The team's been directly involved in the retention or attraction of more than 1,500 jobs, representing an economic impact of more than $10.7 million directly over 5 years, but we like to think that the work we do alongside our many partners, some of which I've mentioned but not all, to promote our strong business climate is indirectly responsible for countless additional impacts. Speaking of promotion, we've seen a 500% or more increase in social media marketing and more than a 900% increase in LinkedIn reach, and we've taken steps to advance joint promotional opportunities with our municipal airport and our tourism partners. We've also worked to focus attention not just on large employers in target industries, but startups and small firms. More than $15,000 has been received from supporters Salt River Project and Arizona Public Service, thank you very much, for Eureka Loft physical enhancements and small business training programs. And the Scottsdale Chamber has relaunched its downtown committee to bring more information and advocacy to firms in the core of the city. I'd like to ask you all who have an interest in supporting the business climate in downtown to either consider joining a meeting or at least help promote it and spread the word. Our employment centers are top of mind when we work to attract and retain business, right? With great success as an employment center that's attracting creative talent, we've also experienced maybe some parking challenges in downtown. Following council's direction, I'm pleased that an interdepartmental city team implemented a number of creative solutions, enhanced enforcement, lowered hourly restrictions in some areas, and a downtown express morning trolley service, which has seen so much usage that on some days, 150 more cars that used to be on the streets are now in garages. So please stay tuned as we work to launch new tools this year that are going to help better track parking usage, enhance enforcement efficiencies, and also guide motorists to available parking. McDowell Corridor is seeing dramatic investment, and SkySong is, of course, ahead of schedule, boasting more than 70 companies and affiliates and more than 1,500 jobs on site. And the new co-working space, 1951 at SkySong, is offering new services to startups in a collaborative university-based environment. And finally, new housing in the area is drawing renters with $50,000 average incomes or greater, and owners with average household incomes between $65,000 and $95,000. These are young professionals, but also empty nesters. I can't leave the podium without asking for help, right? A little request. We are currently gathering feedback to ensure that our strategic plan efforts over the coming years remain focused on what business needs most. Business representatives can visit choosescottsdale.com/news to find this story and access a feedback portal. It's administered by the Mind Suite, a Scottsdale-located company, which is going to aggregate, report, and analyze the results for us. And respondents may remain anonymous if they want to. We need to get to 200 or more minimum. Let's make Scottsdale Forward the group that gets us there. And finally, I mentioned new initiatives on the horizon. We're going to continue to shift our focus on efforts related to top employment center revitalization and investment attraction, including the Scottsdale Air Park and adjacent state land parcels, which many have noted are the most valuable properties in the state land portfolio. So with our partners at GPEC, we also look to support their newly developed foreign direct investment strategy and increase our own international business connections with the Canadian market. It's always fun sharing positive news. Ironically, though, as you all know, our success could be our biggest threat. As more companies enjoy and thrive in Scottsdale, they can also outgrow their space because they're doing so well, and we can find ourselves at a competitive disadvantage locally, regionally, and nationally if other areas can offer Class A space with better parking at lower rates and faster turnarounds. So our team is remaining very vigilant in identifying companies that are at an expansion mode so that we can proactively assist them and work to address their needs, and we can use your involvement. If you're here today, clearly you're already a supporter. In addition to completing the feedback form I mentioned, please help us by staying connected. If you're not currently subscribing to our newsletter or following our social media, please do so. Visit ChooseScottsdale.com today. Thank you so much for your time this morning. Great.
Thanks, Danielle, and thanks for all the hard work that you and your team do every day for us. It's my pleasure now to introduce Kevin Koppler, who's Cox Business Service Director of Enterprise Sales, and he's going to introduce our keynote speaker today. Kevin.
Good morning. This is the commercial part, right? So on behalf of Cox Business and our 3,000 Arizona-based employees, we're very proud to be a member of, not only be a member of the Scottsdale Chamber, but to invest here locally in all the businesses, whether they're enterprise type businesses all the way down to the SoHo type business. So we're very very proud and honored to be here today. We're about a $2 billion company nationwide, part of Cox Communications, which is about an $18 billion company with 30,000 employees. So very proud to be here today, and that's the end of our quick spiel. So this is where I read. So I'm very honored to present Mr. Elliott Pollack today. Elliott is CEO of Elliott D. Pollack and Company, an economic and real estate consulting firm in Scottsdale, which was established in 1987. The firm serves a broad range of clients in both the public and private sector, ranging from law firms, utilities, banks, retailers, major service firms, and real estate-related companies, to states, counties, Native American communities, cities, and universities for both business and policy issues. Elliott has degrees from Boston University and the University of Southern California. He's been a practicing economist for 45 years. For the last 29 years, he's been president of an economic and real estate consulting firm that bears his name. Mr. Elliott Pollack.
I will say it's a pleasure to be here, and I'm a little biased. I live at the waterfront, and my travels are extensive around the country, and this is probably, especially this time of year, the finest place in the country to be. Let me start. Let's see if this works. Yeah. All right. Let me go back, because this is sort of the name of the talk. The stagnation narrative is over. Now, let me tell you a story. I had to give a speech on November 10th, and on the evening of November 9th, this was the name of the speech, and I was, you know, out of state giving this talk, and I read it, and I stayed up till 2 in the morning rewriting it, because, like you, I expected a Democratic president and a Republican Congress, and I don't know if any of you like football, but essentially, I'll just... this is what I, after November 8th, this is what I essentially named the thing. And again, I think I had some help, I don't know. Now, if I'm an economist, I think virtually any economist will tell you if you want to grow an economy, you have to do four things. You basically have to lower tax rates. You have to have less burdensome and less capricious regulation. You have to reduce barriers to international trade, and you have to reduce barriers to credit creation. And keep that in mind as I go through this, because what I'm going to talk to you about is in the first part of the talk, is what Trump says he's going to do. It's going to be interesting as to whether how much of this gets through Congress, and certainly in the first 7 weeks of the presidency, it's been interesting, to say the least. But let's talk about what we're in for. First of all, you're going to have lower tax rates. And this is what one of his proposals is. This is the one on basically his website. Essentially, to reduce personal tax rates to a maximum rate of 33, down from 39.6. The lowest rate is going to be 12%, and essentially it's down from 15. There's going to be higher standard deductions and lower a cap on itemized deductions, essentially. But the big news is corporate tax rates. He's talking about reducing corporate tax rates from 39 to 15, and having a repatriation tax on cash outside of the country of only 10%, and that will incent a lot of people to bring back a lot of money. Now, why is corporate tax rates a big deal? Because right now, the U.S. has the highest corporate tax rate in the industrialized world. And so all the incentives are for people not to be here instead of to be here. He's talking about reducing the U.S. corporate tax rate, so it would be the lowest tax rate in the industrialized world. And if that were to happen, that would be a game changer in terms of where corporations locate, where they choose to expand. And that's a major part of what he wants to do. In terms of regulation, he wants to reduce regulation, repeal parts of Dodd-Frank, which essentially are constraining lending. And obviously, he's going to do some pretty draconian things to the EPA. And here's why. Something called economically significant regulation is a regulation that has more than $100 million in costs. And you can see that it's really increased significantly, especially under President Obama. And Trump thinks that has been a constraint on the growth of the U.S., and he's probably right, quite frankly. He is also talking on top of that of massive infrastructure spending, and that would create a lot of jobs in construction, steel manufacturing, transportation, water, telecom, and energy. And quite frankly, both parties kind of agree that that needs to be done because our infrastructure, our roads, our bridges, our airports are falling apart. If you've been around the world, you can see the difference in the industrialized world anyway, between our infrastructure and the infrastructure of the rest of the world. And so that essentially is likely to happen and happen fairly quickly. Okay, so in terms of energy, he wants us to be energy independent, and that is likely to happen quickly. And with trade, obviously, some draconian measures. He wants a protectionist stance. He wants a leveled playing field. And that is going to be a problem with China because that's the most unlevel of the playing fields with our significant trading partners. He's going to renegotiate NAFTA. I found it interesting, by the way, that both the President of Mexico and the Prime Minister of Canada agreed to renegotiate NAFTA before he had even asked. So that tells you essentially what's going on. And the Trans-Pacific Partnership is out. Other things, he's going to be tough on immigration, and we'll talk about that because it's really a restructuring of immigration that's necessary. In effect, we are going to need labor from outside because we don't have enough labor to fulfill what he wants to do within the borders of this country at the moment. So that's going to turn out to be interesting. Obviously, he's struggling with what to do with Obamacare, and he's a big advocate of school choice, which will benefit us. All right, now what keeps me up at night, okay? And there are four things that keep me up at night. First, a trade war. In essence, is he negotiating or is he going to create a situation where we're going to have a trade war, especially with Mexico, and that would hurt Mexico dramatically. It would hurt us as a state, but it would hurt Mexico more. It remains to be seen. But essentially, this is a potential problem. Other potential problems, these set of policies have been tried four times in the 20th century, and they succeeded each time. And by the way, they were tried by two Republicans and two Democrats. They worked like a charm. The big deal, though, is these policies were tried in the early stages of recovery, coming out of recession. They've never been tried 95, 96, 97 months into a recovery. And so it's going to be interesting to see what happens when you are driving an economy into essentially hyperspeed, well into an expansion. And that's, again, going to create labor problems, interestingly enough. And he's got to get his policies so they coordinate with one another. You can't try to prevent people from coming here when you need labor. Again, what types of labor? There are 500,000 high-tech jobs going wanting. But also, I don't know if any of you are in the construction industry, the number one issue in the construction industry right now is lack of labor. Most of the labor, if you have ever been to a job site, comes from south of the border, and they're just not coming at the moment. Interestingly enough, we can talk about why they're not coming, but it's not what you think. It's something over which he has no control. We'll talk about that in a minute. All right, so there's something called potential GDP. How much, where the economy should be if all its resources were properly employed. And this is, you can see that the blue line, and which is potential, and the red line, which is actual, deviate. Let's take a closer look at it. In this cycle, the difference between actual and potential was very, very high, coming out of the Great Recession. Years later, we're still below potential GDP. That gap will close rapidly under Trump's policies, especially, again, if the tax policies occur and there is no trade war. Okay. One thing, though, that you have to be aware of is that only part of what he says he's going to do is possible to accomplish. At the end of World War II, 50% of all the jobs in this country were manufacturing jobs. 1975, about 22% of all the jobs in the country were manufacturing jobs. And now, basically a little more than 8% of all the jobs in the country are manufacturing jobs. The U.S. is a country that produces more services than goods. It's reliant on we just don't produce things anymore because it is more cost effective to have them produced in other markets. What Trump is doing will be a holding pattern in terms of keeping jobs here, manufacturing jobs here a little longer, but this is a trend that is not likely to be changed in the long run. All right, so again, you can expect faster growth in jobs and GDP. You can expect higher interest rates. You'll probably get that today, as a matter of fact. Inflation's going to be higher, not hyperinflation, but certainly probably around 3%. You're going to get higher after-tax profits. You're going to have a higher deficit. International trade could flourish, but it depends on what his policies finally turn out to be. And again, we are going to be in a situation where we are going to be perennially short of labor, just the opposite of what we've had. And for millennials, that means they're actually going to have to go to work. But we'll talk about that a little more. You're also going to have a larger military. State taxes are going to mostly go away. Political correctness, in case you haven't noticed, has sort of been on the decline. And it would be almost impossible for any president, regardless of whether Hillary got elected or Trump got elected, it would have been impossible to get through the next 4 years without a recession. I shouldn't say impossible, it would be a low probability event, and here's why. The longest recovery in U.S. history is 120 months. We're at month 95 now. The chances of getting through another 48 months without a recession, very, very, very low probability. It would be unprecedented in our history. So again, we're facing a potential for significant positive change in economic growth. It's too early to determine, though, how much is going to get through Congress. But if done correctly, this is going to make a significant difference, like it or not. And you'll see from consumer confidence surveys, consumers, whether they like Trump or not, are real happy about the perspectives for the economy, the prospects for the economy. All right, so let's talk about what's going on now. I wanted to give you that as background because there's been so much garbage floating around the news, you really don't know what you're looking at. So, can the expansion last? Okay. The answer is yes, okay? Is the sky falling? Absolutely not, okay? Let me go back one. This is GDP over the last 50 some odd years, and as you can see, this expansion by historic standards has been mediocre, anemic, whatever you want to call it. And that is probably going to change a little over the next couple of years. It's going to actually grow more rapidly. Again, as I told you before, the longest cycle in U.S. history is 120 months, and we're at month 93. This recovery is not ancient, but it's old. But the thing about this recovery, it's had the slowest rate of growth in U.S. history. There has never been a recovery this slow. Now, the interesting thing about this is recoveries usually mimic the recession that preceded them. So the weaker the economy, the more potential there is, the more pent-up demand there is, and usually the faster the rate of economic growth. In this, we had huge amounts of potential, huge amounts of pent-up demand, and you still had very slow growth. That is a policy issue. And again, with that changing, things are going to be a little more interesting. The expansion is middle-aged. It's not quite old yet. Expansions don't die of old age. But like people, as you get older, you become more vulnerable to shocks, more vulnerable to diseases. And right now, there are no shocks on the horizon. There's no asset bubbles. Tightening of credit. Credit is still going to be loosened, so I'm not concerned about that. Leading indicators, still up. Consumer confidence is, consumer confidence has actually spiked since he was elected. The Treasury spread, this is the most constant indicator of a recession, and that's the spread between 10-year bond rates and a 30-year, or 30-month, 3-month bill rate. And again, when it, that when the yield curve inverts, that's sort of a historic sign of a recession. We're nowhere close to that. From this, the New York Fed has created a recession indicator, and as you can see, they're thinking the odds of the recession, a recession over the next year are somewhere around 4%. So almost, in economic terms, that's almost zero. So the economy should continue to expand in 17 and 18, and the rate of growth should be higher this year and next than it has been, especially once the policies get through Congress. The only thing that bothers me right now, there are excess inventories, especially in autos. Even with that, though, the age of the auto fleet continues to get older. People are keeping their cars longer, and that, to me, suggests that it's not that much of a problem. All right, so let's go through the economy quickly. First, debt burden is low, okay? And by that I mean there's something called the financial obligations ratio, and that's how much of your current income is used to pay for previously accumulated debt. And as you can see, that's way down. We're back where we were in the early 80s. And so that means consumers have gotten their house in order. Secondly is consumer credit. The upper line is two things. It's auto loans and it's student loan debt. We'll talk about that at more length in a couple of minutes. The bottom line is credit card debt, and credit card debt today is lower than it was in 2007. So again, it's a sign that consumers are playing things closer to the vest. They learned something from the Great Recession. They're getting their financial house in order, and that's going to hold them in good stead. Consumers have a lot of liquid assets at this point. There's no irrational exuberance. Net worth is improving. Real income is up. Inflation's low. There's no capacity issues. The government is not a drag on the economy anymore. Fed policy is going to continue to be expansive. The last thing the Fed wants is a recession. What they're doing now is they're trying to get some bullets in their gun. And by that I mean they have to have interest rates high enough by the time a recession does strike a few years down the road to actually cut rates at that point to help alleviate the problems. Housing prices are up, but only modestly or moderately. And so the probability of recession are, in my opinion, very low. And the effect of the election is this could get interesting. In fact, it already has gotten interesting, obviously. All right, let's talk about Arizona, Greater Phoenix, and specifically Scottsdale. This is an unusual recovery in that historically about two-thirds of the employment growth in a recovery has been in the Greater Phoenix area. In this particular recovery, about 86% of all the jobs in the state have been created in Greater Phoenix. Essentially, what I've been quoted as saying, and I believe it's true, is that you have Greater Phoenix and the rest of the state could disappear and nobody would notice for several weeks. And economically, that's kind of true. Now, what's gone on is that essentially things are different. For though, how many people have been here, were here prior to 2008? Okay, so most people. So you have an idea that this doesn't feel the same as a recovery. It's just been slower. And But I want to tell you, we've done okay relative to other places. It's only relative to the way we were prior to 2008 that has changed. So you have to look at the world differently. There's a pre-2007 world and there's a post-2007 world. And so keep that in mind as I go through these numbers, okay? In terms of Arizona's rank out of the 50 states, except during recessions, we were always like second, third, usually just behind Nevada. Obviously, since 2008, that has changed significantly. And last year, we were ninth out of 50 states, which isn't bad. It's not second, but it's certainly respectable. And in terms of, there are, at the present time, 34 major employment markets in the country. A major employment market has more than 1 million jobs. And again, we used to rank first or second, except during recessions we fell a little. But in this recovery, it's really been much weaker. Last year, again, we were, as you can see, ninth. Again, not bad, but not normally what people in Phoenix are used to. All right, so the question is, what's going on? Now, again, this is happening for two reasons, the subnormal national recovery, but a slowdown in population flows both nationally and to Greater Phoenix. I'm going to talk about this because this is the single most significant thing that has changed in this cycle relative to historic cycles. And it affects places that grow rapidly more than places that don't grow rapidly. And so we've been affected. All right, so what's happened, okay? What's happened is that historically, and I'll show you the data in a minute, coming out of a recession, Greater Phoenix usually has a pretty low unemployment rate and starts creating a lot of jobs. Now, in order to fill those jobs, people are pulled in from other states. They move here to fill those jobs. Well, when they move here, they create their own demand for goods and services. Somebody comes here, he needs a place to live, he probably buys a suit at Dillard's or Macy's, he buys a car from Courtesy Chevrolet, he goes to a ball game, he gets a Slurpee. All the things that people do create demand. In order to fill the jobs created by the demands of those new people, more people have to come in. So population growth is essentially an industry in Arizona. Well, right now we're growing at about half of normal. And because there are fewer people coming in, you aren't getting those ripple effects of those people. And let me show you some data on that. First, the unemployment rate. This recovery, we started with an unemployment rate which was literally about 50-60% higher than normal. In addition, it took till 2014 to where we got an unemployment rate that was low enough to say, where I could say, that was the peak of unemployment in past cycles. Think about that. It took all the way to 2014 to reach what had previously been the highest point in unemployment. We're still probably a couple of percentage points higher than we should be at this point in the cycle. And so you don't get as many people coming in because a lot of the jobs are filled by people who are here locally looking for jobs. So that's one thing that's going on. And again, the second thing is that, again, take a look at the right column. The average monthly gain during a recovery. And you can see that the average monthly gain is starting to pick up steam, but it's really weaker than any other recovery we've had. And again, fewer people mean fewer houses, less construction, less Slurpees. And so the unemployment, the employment growth, again, we haven't even come close to our pre-2008 average. It's been, for us, an anemic recovery. Something else you ought to think about. If one of the things that's happened here is the labor force participation rate, and that is the percentage of people 18 to 64 who are in the labor force has really fallen off a cliff. It's gone from basically about 69% to about 62%, and it's much worse here than nationally, because nationally is the blue line. And so you could say, what's happening? Well, there are a lot of people who simply just threw in the towel, said, well, I can't get a job, I'm not gonna, I'm just not even gonna look, so you're out of the labor force. Trump's plan, if it is to work, has to get a bunch of these people to say, you know, it's real easy to get a job, wage rates are going up, I'm gonna start looking again. And that potential exists. That also says to me, in Phoenix, there's a lot of excess labor that needs to, again, get re-engaged, and that's going to prevent a lot of people from being sucked in from the outside, because they can be filled locally. And again, that suggests to me that the relatively slow growth in Phoenix is going to continue a while longer. All right, so let's take a look at what we're talking about. There were years when essentially, if you take into account births over deaths, there was net outflows of people in 2010 and 11. We're now growing, but again, 1.7% is, again, about half of normal for this point in the cycle. As you can see, my forecast, the U of A's forecast, the Department of Administration's forecast, all very close. Still, relative growth is going to increase, but very slowly. Let's take a look at why. We took a look at 2001 to 2006 and compared that to 2011 to 2016, and what we found out was really interesting. Movers from abroad, down over 18%. Movers from other states, down a third. And movers from other countries into the state, or from other counties, rather, down about 14%. If you're moving from Gilbert to Chandler, or from Gilbert to Scottsdale, that doesn't create any new demand in the market. I don't care about that. I'm just talking about people who come from other places. And that's down literally about almost a quarter from the earlier period. And then on top of that, of the people moving, we captured 8.1% of everybody who moved in 2001 through 2006. We're down to 3.6%. So fewer people are moving, and of those moving, we're capturing a lot less of them. And that is the problem. We also took a look at like individual years, and you can see that in 2000 we essentially, of all the people who moved, the people who moved from outside the local area, which was 7%, it's now down to 4.3%. So essentially a big drop in those people who are moving. And the Arizona capture rate has literally fallen in half. In 2006, one out of every 10 people who moved in the entire country ended up in Arizona. That's phenomenal. It's down to about half that at this point. But again, that's the issue. The issue is not only national in nature, but essentially because we're not creating as many jobs as we did, and there still is excess labor in the state, we're not getting as many people moving here. That will change a little, but it's going to change slowly. Again, it's going to change slowly because it changes slowly, we're going to have less demand for single family, for office, for construction, and for, again, jobs in general. So again, we are, eighth in population growth, and that's great, really is. It's only when you compare ourselves to what we were prior to 2008, it becomes problematic. Population change, as you can see, is way below normal, but at least it's picking up. That's good news. And the other thing I'll tell you is, even though, if in 2006 and 7, you had 140,000 people moving to Greater Phoenix. Last year, you had about 76,000. So that's about almost 70,000 people who aren't here. And that really affects goods and service sales. Okay, so essentially, it's going to be a slow recovery in this. Here's what the Department of Administration is saying, between 15 and 20, 1.9%, but between 20 and 25, they also believe it'll stay really at about 1.9%. Just to show you the difference, that means by 2025, there'd be about 5.4 million people here. If that goes to 2.25%, that would be 5.6 million people. And if it goes to 2.5%, it would be another basically 350,000 people. So small changes in population percentage growth can have a huge effect. We'll see what happens. All right, let me talk about Scottsdale. There we go, Scottsdale. Housing permits. Again, housing permits in Scottsdale, we are doing better. You can see how much we've recovered from the bottom. Don't compare yourself to pre-2007 because it was a different world. I don't know that we're going to get back there. The red line, though, interestingly, if that the red line is apartments. And as we'll go over in a minute, the demographics for apartments have never been better in the history of mankind. And so when you see all these apartments going up, don't worry, they're going to get filled. So we'll talk about that. And by the way, this is a trend that you are powerless to stop. It is a demographic trend, as we'll go over. And so you can complain all you want about apartments. They're coming. Number of resales. Again, the number of resales is up significantly. Don't look prior to 2007. Don't look at 2003 and 4. But we are doing well in resales. In terms of median prices, again, median prices are up a lot from the bottom, but we are still below the previous peak. Negative equity, this is how many people who are essentially underwater, who have a mortgage that's more than the house is worth, and that's gone from almost 35% of the people in town down to below 10, and that will continue to improve. That's good news. And then taxable sales. Taxable sales have grown rapidly every year since the bottom, but we are still below the previous peak. That's how steep the last recession was. And you can see in 2009, it was just a disaster, down over 18%. And taxable hotel and motel sales essentially are above the previous peak, so that market has totally recovered. It's doing well. And I would expect it to continue to do well. Let me talk about the housing market generally, okay? Okay, so any of you looking for a house? This subdivision, by the way, is not in Scottsdale. Let's talk about the parade of horribles that we had to go through for housing. And the story is getting a lot better and will continue to get better. The parade of horribles includes negative equity, foreclosures, millennials, student loans, and tougher loan standards. And again, how this affects housing permits, there's also unforeseen positives. Again, if employment growth accelerates, that's going to bring in more people, more demand. And then millennials. The interesting thing is, and we'll see this in a minute, the percentage of millennials moving or living with mommy and daddy has actually increased since the end of the recovery. That will change. Again, this quote-unquote labor shortage I'm talking about, which you'll think I'm nuts now, and maybe the next couple of years, but we are going into a period of basically a perennial labor shortage. So wages are going to be going up, and jobs for millennials who really got took the brunt of the hit on the economy, that will change. And by that I mean they were brought up in a period of plenty. They go to college, they get out of college, and there's no jobs. And so that's why their perspective is very interesting. For those people in this room, you were brought up in a time of plenty. You got out of school in the 70s or 80s. You had plenty of jobs. Your kids, the millennials, didn't have that. They got out, no job, sorry. And so their view of the world is completely different than yours. And that view will follow them throughout their lives, even during this period of plenty that I talked about. Okay. If you think you're going to have 2% population growth, there's demographic demand for 33,000 single-family units a year over the next decade. We just had a year we had 18, and that was a great year. And the reason is this, and this is, if you believe that home ownership will stay about the same, and I'll tell you why I think it will in a minute, and you run the age demographics through this, if not one more person moved to town, because there are so many millennials, there would be demand for 150,000 housing units over the next decade. If you add to that the people who are going to be moving to town, that's how we get up to 33,000. Now, there will be a lot of people, a lot of millennials who choose to rent, but they will still rent primarily single-family detached housing. Right now, one out of every five houses in Greater Phoenix is a rental. Think about that. That's going to come down a little, but not a lot. Going into this, it was about 10%. Now it's 20%. This is the homeownership rate, again, is way low. It's where it was back in the 80s, and it's probably going to stay relatively low. But that doesn't mean that millennials won't have single-family homes. They'll rent them instead of buying them. It's a shared economy, and that's where they are. In terms of negative equity, hard to believe, but in Arizona, more than half of all the homes in the state in 2011 were underwater. Now it's down to about 13, and it's going to continue to improve. That frees up, especially nationally, that frees up people to move. A lot of people were locked in their homes, they couldn't move, they didn't have enough equity. Over time, that will help us. This is foreclosures. The blue line is the foreclosures that actually took place. The red line is a seven-year lag. If you're going to get a Fannie or Freddie loan, if you had a foreclosure, you're in a penalty box for 7 years. And you can see that we're in about a little past the middle of all those people being able to re-enter the housing market. That's a positive. Now, this chart and the next chart show that you should never believe anybody who gives you a presentation with a lot of charts, okay? So this, you look at this, and 2012 is 100. You say, wow, look at that. Mortgage availability really has improved. Well, let's go back a few years and take the same thing from 2004. Same chart, except we went back to 2004. Looks a little different. Let's just say anything you read about a housing bubble, this, that, it's nonsense. We aren't even close to normal in terms of the credit availability for the housing market. We've got a way to go, and so I think credit generally will be more available, not less available for housing over the next several years. Let's talk about millennials. I have four millennials, so I speak from experience. There are actually more millennials than there were baby boomers. A millennial is somebody who was born in 85 through 2004, and there's almost 80 million of them. And they will drive everything just as baby boomers did for the next several years. Here's the most interesting thing about millennials. They don't get married, at least not early. In 1960, 64% of those people, 18 through 33, were married. 2004, the latest data we have, 28% of people in the same age cohort were married. When you delay marriage, you delay having children. When you delay having children, you delay the need for housing and the need to act responsibly. You delay all that stuff you go to Home Depot, buy, put in your garage and never use, okay? So this has been quite an effect. Here's the thing I talked to you about. 18 to 34-year-olds, almost one out of every three lives with mommy and daddy. Now, that's remarkable. That will change because jobs are going to get easier and to the point where wages are going to go up, and they'll be able to afford to get out. Believe me, kids don't want to live with you any more than you want them there, okay? I actually used to live in up near Via Linda in Mountain View, and as soon as the last one got out of high school, I moved and didn't leave a forwarding address, but they found me anyway, so. So here's something else they're burdened with. How many of you came out of college, how many of you people 40 years old or older came out of college with student loan debt? Okay, relatively few. I came out with student loan debt, but very little, okay? Take a look at the difference, okay? Student loan debt has quadrupled since 2004. It's gone from $345 billion to $1.3 trillion, okay? This is no different than the housing bubble. The only difference is you could just get your housing debt dismissed in bankruptcy. Your kids are stuck with this. It really is tragic in a lot of ways. And if you want to know why tuition has gone up so much, it's no different than what happened to housing prices. They can. Why do they raise tuition? They can, because they think it's free money, and it's really unfortunate. The National Association of Realtors does a study every year on why people aren't buying houses. The number one reason for 35-year-olds and younger, student loan debt. Not auto debt, we're not making enough money, not healthcare costs. It's student loan debt. And I could go into the numbers on student loan debt. It's going to take a while to work that through. This is not, for most people, it's not postponing a house. It's not saying we're never going to be in a house. For most people, it's we're postponing a house, and the house we buy might be a little smaller than we'd otherwise like, simply because of the way the numbers work out. So this one is, to me, the biggest problem, and it's going to take a while to work out. Again, if you're paying your student loan debt, you're not buying a house, you're not buying furniture, you're not buying beer. Well, maybe you are buying beer. Incomes had better be higher because of their degree. If your kid goes to school and he gets a degree in a marketable skill, great. If your kid is a Russian literature major, he will be the most educated sales clerk at Macy's, okay? And that's not what you want $100,000 in student loan debt for. Okay, let's move on. So the housing is likely to continue to recover. As you can see, the estimates are 20,000 this year, 23,000 next. That is not bad at all. It's a good recovery. One of the biggest problems, I said, is labor. It now takes 9 months to build a house. It should take 6. The number one problem for home builders right now is a shortage of skilled labor. And that labor comes from south of the border. And if I had a wish list, number one on that wish list would be getting work visas for skilled construction labor from south of the border, because otherwise it's going to affect rapidly growing places like Arizona. All right, multifamily. This is what's going near Kierlin, by the way. It's just like, let's take a look at the demographics. You have baby boomers, and because of baby boomers, you've had the huge demand for apartments in the 80s. Take a look at millennials. There's more of them, and it's a longer pattern. So you're going to have a lot of demand for apartments way out into the 30s, to about 2040. This isn't going away, and especially since homeownership rate is lower. Now, not everything built is going to be $2 to $2.50 a square foot per month in rents. Most apartments will be worker housing, $1.40, $1.50 per square foot, and you're going to see a lot of that throughout Phoenix. So you have this huge demographic demand for millennials, but also keep in mind that there's a huge demand for retirement housing because so many people are turning 65. Baby boomers, again, are now, you can see the blue, they're about two-thirds of the way through turning 65. What's going to happen? Those who do have equity in their homes, and a lot of them have their homes free and clear, a reasonable percentage of them will sell their homes, move into a rental unit, and essentially live their lives out on the equity in their home. They'll sell a more expensive home back east and move to a retirement community in Arizona, and that will create demand for rental units as well. So essentially, you have millennials, there's a ton of them, Because they're delaying marriage, they're in apartments probably 6 years longer than baby boomers were. And you have baby boomers who are going to retire, some of whom will end up in apartments. And so you have this demographic wave that's basically has apartments written all over it. This is something else that one of my kids got married last weekend, and I can tell you that when I got married in the 60s, I was 23 and my wife was 21, and this weekend my son was 30 and his wife was 28, and that is pretty typical of what's going on, just the delay in marriage, and that isn't changing, Okay. Something else I had never thought about. Just you think about technology and its effect on, you all know about birth control, but I have a cousin who's about 35, and she's a doctor, and she hasn't gotten around to getting married yet, and so she's having her eggs frozen. It's just the technology has changed the need to get married early. And the economics of getting married doesn't work the way it did for baby boomers because of what's going on in the economy. So it's interesting. Multifamily rents last year went up more than 7%. You don't get a 7% increase in a 2% inflation economy unless there's a supply-demand imbalance. So we're short of apartments. Vacancy rates are likely to stay low, which means that demand will continue. Again, you can see that absorption and completions are pretty well balanced. With everything you read in the paper about all these apartments, it's a relatively small number. And it's not a number that's not going to be absorbed pretty quickly. Let's talk about office. Vacancy rates are finally getting down to a reasonable number. It'll be probably 2018 before you get to 15%. That's usually the number where you spark more demand in office, for building office. Although you can see there's been a lot built. 2015 there was a lot, but you can still see that absorption is exceeding change in inventory, and that suggests vacancy rates are headed down. There are already four markets where vacancy rates are less than 10%, and an apartment office, that's a shortage, because if you have less than 10%, a big user comes into town, he can't go there, okay? There's not a big enough floor plate. So one of those, obviously, is South Scottsdale. Scottsdale as a whole, Central Scottsdale, Downtown Scottsdale, South Scottsdale, and North Scottsdale should be a major beneficiary when the building boom in office starts. There's 1.6 million square feet under construction, basically 900,000 square feet of that is one particular company. 700,000 square feet is spec space. That's not nearly enough. How about industrial? Again, vacancy rates are coming down. It's been a big box world. Look at the amount of absorption, tremendous absorption, basically big box users. The small guy, the construction-related guy, that hasn't come back yet. But the absorption is still way in excess of the change in inventory, and again, strong demand for industrial as well. And there's 4.2 million square feet under construction. And you say, well, that sounds like a lot. It's less than half of what we built last year. So essentially, we need more, not less, at this moment in time. Retail. So retail has changed. Retail meant one thing to baby boomers. It means something else to millennials. Retail, given the technologies that exist today, essentially becomes an entertainment experience. Yes, you got to get your hair cut, you got to get your nails done, but the retailer, the shops, you know, all that stuff, that's now essentially an entertainment experience. And if you go to malls, you'll see that. There's more things that are entertainment looking. There's more things that try to draw you in. But it's going to be difficult. I will dare say that the number of major retail stores, department stores we see, It's going to go down. There are going to be fewer of them, and at least several names that you grew up with and just think about as normal, that's gone. All right, so let me finish real quickly. Vacancy rates are coming down, but there's still very little absorption and very little inventory, and retail sales are okay, but never really boomed. And here's why. E-commerce, my house is like a warehouse. I come every day, there's three more boxes, and usually three go back for every three that come in, but my wife, I don't think she's been in a mall in months, which is great. All right, so how's this gonna turn out? Well, again, the world has changed pre-2007, post-2007. Again, no traditional boom in Phoenix unless population increases, but after 2000, eight, the cycle is going to change significantly. It'll be positive. Before 2008, I was saying to people, this is as good as it gets. What I'm telling people now is, it probably isn't. It's probably going to get better. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Elliott, for all of those insights. And I really love the slides. Don't you guys love those slides? And I appreciate the reminder and that slow growth is better than no growth, because I have no patience whatsoever, and that's what we need right now. So thank you again, Elliott. Big round of applause, please, for Elliott. At this time, we're going to move into our CEO panel, and I'd like to welcome to the stage David Bentler, Manager of Community and Economic Development at APS. He's today's moderator. And along with our CEO panel guests, we have Brent Herrington, President and CEO of DMB, Candace Wiest, President and CEO, West Valley Bank Corp and West Valley National Bank, Tom Clark, President and CEO, Nationwide Mutual Insurance Company, Excess and Surplus Specialty Company, and Tom Sadvary, President and CEO of Honor Health. Welcome, everybody. David, lead us on a fantastic session. I know that you will.
But let's just get started. Let's just ask a simple question. You know, how are we doing? How's Scottsdale doing? You guys are all in Scottsdale. How's Scottsdale working for you? We'll start off with you.
Well, so I have to tell you, I am unabashedly a cheerleader for Scottsdale. I agree with the comment you heard Elliott make earlier. I travel all over this country, and every time I come home, I'm so very pleased to be back. There's so many reasons to love it. It's not perfect. I'm sure in the conversation we'll have some of that imperfection will come out a little bit in the conversation. But it's a pretty great place, and it's been a great place for us to do business, so we're happy.
Great.
Yeah.
Tom?
Yeah, I would say the same thing. I mean, what's not to like, and it's a great place to live, work, and play, and we have a big population of associates here, and I think, for the most part, they're very happy in terms of the facility that we work in and the amenities that are available to them.
Great. I just realized one thing. I'm supposed to introduce you guys with a quick bio. So I'm going to do that, actually, so before we get started any farther. Brent Herrington, who you just heard from a little bit ago, is the CEO of DMB and provides strategic leadership for the DMB organization and oversees all aspects of the company's operations. Herrington joined DMB in 1998 and has led several of the company's flagship projects, including DC Ranch and Silverleaf, and we're going to hear more about those later on. A graduate of the Advanced Management Development Program in Real Estate at Harvard University. Harvard, they're known for football, basketball, I don't know. He is recognized nationally as a thought leader in the community development industry. Please help me thank and welcome Brent. So we're catching up with this. Candace Hunter Wiest is president of CEO of West Valley Bancorp and West Valley National Bank. During 2007, the bank opened offices in Goodyear, Avondale, and North Scottsdale, and the bank received regulatory approval to open a full-service branch in Scottsdale in 2011. In 2003, Wiest was elected director of the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco and was elected for a second term in 2006. She is the first woman to be elected as a Class A director in the bank's 95-year history. I think that's pretty cool. Also, I thought what was neat is she is also one of four members search committee to recruit President Janet Yellen, the current vice chair of the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve Bank. So that's interesting. Currently serves as a director and member of Greater Phoenix Leadership, Governor Brewer, appointed Ms. Wiest to the board of Arizona Commerce Authority, a group that I'm very familiar with, and you have been recognized as trendsetter by Trends Magazine and the 50 Most Influential Women in Arizona, 2011 Most Admired CEOs Business Journal. Please help me welcome Candace Wiest. Thomas Clark, president of Nationwide. Thomas Clark brings more than 26 years of technical leadership experience to the insurance industry to Nationwide. Tom first joined in September of 2014 as a senior vice president and assumed the role of president in December 2015, leading a $3 billion organization and more than 1,700 associates in Scottsdale. Tom is focused on delivering profitable growth through strengthening distribution partnerships, creating great environment for associates, and effective managing resources. Tom is on the board of St. Mary's Food Bank Alliance in Phoenix and is also the leader of the Nationwide National Pride Affinity Group out of Columbus. He resides in Scottsdale, Arizona. Please welcome Tom. And last but not least, Tom Sadvary is CEO of Honor Health, where he led the creation of a $1.5 billion nonprofit organization through affiliation of the Scottsdale Healthcare and John C. Lincoln Health Network in 2013. Tom is a fellow in the American College of Healthcare Executives. He continues to lead the community and professional development through the involvement of the American Hospital Association, Greater Phoenix Leadership Council, Scottsdale Institute and Health Insights, and I understand that you're also going to be honored in the 2017 Honor Ball, so that's going to be really neat. So please help me welcome Tom Sadvary. So now I can get back to those questions. We already kind of started, didn't we? But we are talking about, Tom, we're going to Candace next, I guess, about why Scottsdale?
Well, part of our niche at the bank is medical and dental industries. And so originally we moved here for those two industries, and our other problem was sourcing talent. And we've been able to solve both of those problems by being at Scottsdale. And today it is our highest volume loan branch, which is pretty interesting. And our average wage, by the way, is about $95,000.
Oh, wow.
In that branch. So that's where our credit group is. So we're happy to be in Scottsdale in lots of ways.
And we're happy to have you. Thank you. Tom Sadvary.
Well, Scottsdale Healthcare, now Honor Health, has been integrated with the fabric of this community since we opened back in 1962, and the population of Scottsdale back then was 20,000 people. And it's, as a locally owned nonprofit health system, now Honor Health is really committed to meeting and understanding the healthcare needs of our community, whether it's trying to keep nutritional needs in high schools or solving some really esoteric cancer diseases that our patients face.
Great, so. Thank you. Well, Tom Clark, and I see you wore your beautiful socks today.
I did.
And you got the memo because last year I was chastised because I wore plain black socks and the other panelists wore fancy socks. So I went out this time, and you did as well. So I'm really glad to see that. But an important question for you, I think, is, you know, could you hum the Nationwide jingle for us?
I thought you said backstage you liked me. This is the impression I'm going to leave with the crowd.
You know. Just wondering.
No good could come from that. I think we'll leave that up to Peyton Manning.
Oh. All right. Well, that's been something else. How about the audience? Anyone out there? That was really good. I like that. I'll bet you one of those was Doreen, your employee. But, okay, seriously now, your company's been in Scottsdale for 35 years, actually, growing at a healthy pace. And how do you see Nationwide in Scottsdale growing over the next 3 to 5 years?
I don't have an exact number, but as you mentioned earlier, we have about 1,700 associates on our Scottsdale campus. We have some other associates over on Pima Center. And right now, we're actually looking for more real estate. Nationwide would like to build a new facility here, and I would see some major expansion in terms of the number of folks we would bring into the area. As Candace mentioned, just average wage per associate for us is somewhere in the $80,000 to $100,000 range, so we'd be bringing great jobs here. But we could see the expansion growing by about 50% over the next 3 to 5 years. Our challenge is the real estate.
The real estate, finding the amount of land that you need.
Correct. Okay. We own all our properties over at Ganey Ranch, and we're just landlocked there. I mean, we love the location. We love the location within Scottsdale itself. The challenge is we just can't grow on that campus any longer.
Okay. Well, we might explore that area just a little bit longer and shortly here. Very good. Anybody else have any thoughts on potential expansions in Scottsdale or for your companies?
What on our health, we have 3 hospital campuses in Scottsdale, and all 3 of them will be experiencing growth, particularly at the Osborne campus. We're going to be developing a neurosciences center, which is much needed for our community. We continue to expand our cancer services at Shea, and there's a lot of demographic growth in the Thompson Peak area, and we've just opened up a brand new orthopedic unit and an orthopedic center for the patients in that area.
Well, we appreciate it.
And we have several primary care and ambulatory sites that are being developed as people want access to that kind of care close to where they live and work, and we want to provide that service.
Thank you, and we appreciate everything you guys are doing. Brent Herrington.
Yes.
DMV has done some amazing projects in Arizona, in particular DC Ranch, Silverleaf, and now One Scottsdale. And we'd love to have you tell us a little bit about One Scottsdale.
So some of you may remember that back, you know, kind of circa 2005, 6, 7, we were very deep in planning a very aggressive retail and entertainment anchored mixed use community. Had been through zoning, we're deep into tenanting the retail. And I'm just going to look above and thank God we didn't start, because it would have been a calamity of massive proportions if we had launched in the fashion that we set out to do, where it would have been so aggressive, so much investment, so much vertical activity coming up right into the teeth of a once-in-a-lifetime downturn. So,
sure.
So in any event, so we're relieved about that. The sad reality is that in the intervening time, and again, back in that era, some of you would remember there was the great retail war that was playing out, where you had the promise of a big retail project at City North in Desert Ridge. You had Macerich or Westcor back then focused on the Palisade site on the northwest corner, on the Phoenix side of Scottsdale Road on the northwest corner. You had the privately owned One Scottsdale site in Scottsdale on the northeast corner. And then, of course, Carolyn was already in place. And so there was a tremendous battle over who was going to tie up the department store anchors, because 10 years ago, traditional department store anchored retail was still how big retail happened. Yeah. In the intervening 10 years, that business model has largely unraveled. You know, big department store boxes are not really the driver for the kinds of retail that work today, that people want today. And meanwhile, City North did launch, you know, back when I'm thanking God we didn't. They did, and you can kind of see what happened there. And meanwhile, Scottsdale Quarter happened that consumed a lot of the retail demand. So the biggest question mark right now for us as we move the One Scottsdale project forward is how much and what type of retail is still operative in the market and ready to go to that location. But I think I would just broadly let you guys know we are really working hard on that right now. It is the center of our gun sights in terms of getting One Scottsdale moving. You will see office development probably breaking ground before the end of this year. Next generation, you know, the kind of employment environments that today's employers want. And we're very hopeful that we'll be breaking ground on some exciting new things next year.
Great. Well, I have one final question for the panel, and I really appreciate everything you guys have said. If you could have one wish from the city of Scottsdale that would provide the greatest benefit to your company, what would that be? We'll start over here, Tom.
Comprehensive transportation plan.
Thank you. Candace?
Workforce development.
Workforce development, great.
I would say workforce development and property development.
Great. Brent?
You know, just as real estate-oriented people, our team at DMB would really love, you know, if we were getting very clear signals from Scottsdale about what Scottsdale's own ambitions are for, you know, the important different areas of the city, where we could listen, say, okay, understand, that makes sense to us, let us go away and think about how to deliver what you guys want. So I think just sharpening up exactly what's wanted and then putting in place an understanding about constraints and, you know, zoning, height, intensity, you know, all of those things that matter to real estate. You know, so again, we'd like to go to work and help fulfill whatever the vision is, but we just need a better understanding of what it is.
Thank you. Well, what a wonderful discussion. We really appreciate you guys are over thousands of jobs. You're responsible for thousands of jobs in Scottsdale, so you're very important to this community. Please help me thank this panel for that wonderful discussion. Thank you. All right.
Okay, very exciting and insightful. Let's give our CEO panel another round of applause, and of course, our CEO moderator, David Bentler. And would you also join me in thanking Elliott Pollack for being with us today? I'm glad I didn't have to follow him because he always gives a great presentation. That's really funny. Thank you, David. Couple of comments just to kind of wrap today up. You know, Elliott really pointed out a lot of really interesting facts that are going to impact us. I want you to know that the Scottsdale Chamber of Commerce has been around here a whole long time. We've been here this month 70 years, so 3 or 4 years actually before the city incorporated. And I'm proud of everything that I've heard today. The future looks bright. And I think that's seeing and hearing from everybody and their presentations in these CEO panel that made such a difference. I have a couple of comments with what I thought. You know, the first one I'm not so sure of, that we live on the surface of the sun. I'm like, you know, I guess I've felt that way a few times, but it never has impacted me. 9 out of 10 companies that Danielle has been talking with are hiring and expanding. SkySong has 1,500 jobs out there. 34% of millennials are living with their parents. I can testify to that. My 20-year-old son moved back with me from Santa Barbara. Why would you leave Santa Barbara to come back and live with your dad? I think it's what's happening in the country and the state. State land, you know, we saw that chart up there. Obviously, there's a lot of things the city can't do about it, but I know I have had a lot of discussions with them, and they've got some creative options that they are looking at. So I look forward to hearing from them in the future. Transportation. Last year we asked that same question about light rail, and 75% said they wanted us to look at it, and this year 70%. I think the key, and what we heard from our panelists, is that we need to do it the right way. We've got to make it a realistic way, and we've got to make sure that it's affordable. The future and what it holds for us, its leadership, and its voices like yours out there in the community that need to be heard when things like bonds come up and or elections come up. Let's not let a few decide what our future will be here in Scottsdale. DDC, 65% in favor of it, 35 not. I think that's an education project for all of us. So as we continue to get closer to August, when we'll hear more about it, let's make sure we've looked at it and have decisions that are based on educated facts. In closing, Don Henninger, would you please come back so we can give you a round of applause for doing such a great job as Master of Ceremonies. I'd also like to thank our sponsors one more time for the continued support of Scottsdale Forward. Without you, events like today could not happen. And I'd also like to take a moment to thank the Scottsdale Forward Planning Committee for all their time and work in making today's program such a success. Doreen leads it for us, and she has done a great job. We have been meeting almost a half a year to make sure today was successful. A special thanks to my staff at the Chamber and all the other volunteers that were here today. Now, in closing, thank you very much for being here.